Artificial intelligence is everywhere these days, with programs like ChatGPT threatening to revolutionize everything from education and marketing to television, shopping, manufacturing, and even healthcare. Boston Children's recently posted a job opening for an AI prompt engineer to integrate ChatGPT into healthcare. And the hospital has already used AI to read patient scans and predict how long they will stay in the ICU. But with a lot of progress comes a lot of concern. And calls are growing for government officials and world leaders to step in. Hundreds of industry leaders recently shared a joint statement written by the Center for AI Safety, warning that AI poses a threat of mass extinction and that mitigating that risk should be a global priority. Even some top U.S. officials are agreeing, promising a multinational approach.
I think we share a conviction that the TTC has an important role to play in helping establish voluntary codes of conduct that would be open to all like-minded countries, particularly because there's almost always a gap when new technologies emerge between the time at which those technologies emerge and have an impact on people and the time it takes for governments and institutions to figure out how to legislate or regulate.
So what's the best way forward with AI? Is it worth the risk, or is it too much for regulators to handle? I'm joined now by two MIT professors, Daron Acemoglu, professor of economics, and Alexander Madri, a professor of computing and co-chair of MIT's AI Policy Task Force. Thank you, Daron, Alexander. Thanks for joining us today. Now, speaking also as an MIT PhD, I think if the world is going to end, MIT should be involved. Like, that's important.
We'll try to make it end faster. Yes, we'll do that.
So I have to ask, right? It's when we talk about the threats from technology, we often hear about job displacement, even climate change. The word extinction doesn't get thrown around too often, but that's what people are talking about today. So does that make sense? Where does that level of threat come from?
I think it doesn't, to be honest. But Alexander will have more of the computing aspect. But I think this is really not the right focus. It exaggerates the capabilities of the current technologies and makes us shift the focus from the more mundane damage that these new models are likely to cause in terms of misinformation, job displacement, democratic threats, and all sorts of small things that are going to be part of our lives as these are rolled out in an uncontrolled, unregulated manner.
Yeah, so just if I can kind of add something to this, we have to realize that AI is technology that is changing everything, like every aspect of society. And even though I agree that the current technology, I don't think it has a threat of extinction, I think all these calls talk more about what might happen in the future and us being prepared for that. Having said that, I agree with Daron that we really need to pay attention to these more immediate threats and dangers here. And yeah, I hope that a lot of regulation that we will be working on as a country will focus on that too.
If extinction seems like an overestimate of the threat problem, then in the next 5 years, what is it that you're most worried about from AI?
So first of all, I'm not sure what happens in 5 years. That seems like an eon in the context of AI. But the things I am very concerned right now are essentially the fact that much of our society is driven by informational spaces, in particular social media and online media in general. And AI, in particular generative AI, brings about a lot of problems, exacerbates a lot of problems that we know already. So think misinformation, think spam, think spear phishing, think blackmail. There's also this threat of what I would call individual persuasion, where essentially you can have now not just the same message spammed to many people, but actually individual message or even conversations that you could have with different individuals trying to persuade them to do something like buy a particular product or maybe vote for a particular candidate. There's also more traditional questions like perpetuation of biases. You know, a lot of AI systems are trained on data that does not properly reflect our societal societal principles, and that's a problem. And then there is a question of restructuring the job market, which is something that Daron is particularly well suited to talk about. So these are the things that I'm really worried about. These are the things that are happening right now, and we need to act.
So Daron, all of these seem like problems that we're already seeing at some level from other types, sort of maybe less advanced technologies. How much worse is this than the election interference and, you know, spam calls that make my cell phone unusable than what we've all, how much worse is it than what we're already seeing right now?
I don't think that we know the answer to that, because as Alexander also emphasized, generative AI is advancing very rapidly. But your instinct is right as far as I'm concerned. There is a lot of continuity with the digital technologies of the last 20 years or with earlier versions of AI. I think we can learn a lot from what those technologies did, in what ways they failed, in what ways they made the problem of democratic discourse forming information exchange or, you know, increasing productivity without displacing workers, how all of these things became much harder. And once we learn those lessons, I think there's a lot that we can do in the domain of generative AI so that we use these technologies more responsibly. But what I worry about is, again, the hype. I think OpenAI has really excelled in generating hype about this technology. And that hype is actually not helping. It's making people go from one extreme of being amazingly optimistic about what these things are going to go. And then the same people then say, talk about existential risks. But we just leave the nitty gritty of regulating these technologies, integrating them in a responsible way into our businesses, into our social lives, by the wayside.
So if I were to dive into the hype for a second, it strikes me that how much of this is people talking their book, right? If I was the CEO of an AI startup, my technology is so powerful it might end humanity is warning, but it's also telling the world just how good what I do, I am at what I actually do. Is that part of what's driving
that? 100%, 100%. I think the AI community has really excelled in generating hype. Part of it is because it elevates them socially. Secondly, it makes all sorts of investors become much more excited. And third, some of this hype is presented in such a way that actually makes their competitors fall into a difficult position. So Sam Altman says, oh, it's existential risk. We should definitely regulate AI, but don't slow down our own training. So what that means is that we don't want our competitors to do very well. So I think there's a lot of self-regarding sort of justification here, as well as a very clever attempt at making ChatGPT, GPT-4 appear much more capable than they really are.
Alexander, is that your take too?
So I just want to add a bit different comments. I think there is indeed a lot of different parties trying to push very different messages. Actually, what happened is not only that there is a group of people you would call trying to hype the dangers of AI, although again, I don't think we should dismiss all of that. Like, I think there is some merit. It's like, you know, think about when we were developing cars, if someone started talking about climate change, we probably would not view it, it would be a legitimate concern, but maybe not the most immediate one to tackle. What is interesting is that, you know, there are people that Daron refers to, but then there are people who are kind of on the opposite of this, which is like, it's called like this crit hype. It's essentially just now criticizing AI, which also became a very kind of very well represented and very active topic. And kind of what happens as a result, and we know this already in different contexts, is that there are these two different groups that are kind of polar opposite of each other, but actually most of the people are in the middle. And kind of these people are not getting the oxygen to talk about the ideas, because these are the people who will actually fix things and will actually make them right. So that's something that I am worried about in this space.
So if they're not getting the oxygen, let's give them some. If there is a need for regulation of this environment, what are your suggestions for the principles that should guide it? How do we think through shaping this technology that seems like it's changing the world almost on a day-to-day basis? Alexander, do you want to start?
Well, there is no like short answer to this. So actually, from my conversation with the policymakers, it's like each one of them asked me the version of this question, and I say, there is no silver bullet here. This is a technology that touches on every facet of our society. And there's a reason why our legal system is so complicated, because these different facets are so diverse.
There's no silver bullet, but let me give you five policies that I think we should consider. First of all, these models completely expropriate data that other people generated for other purposes. You know, without Wikipedia and the boundless energy that thousands of people, tens of thousands of people put into Wikipedia, these GPT models wouldn't be half of the wiseness they have. So why are we letting these people's data to be exploited? So we need some sort of data regulation and property rights on creative data. I think this is actually central to the WGA strike right now. It's a completely central issue. Second, the business model that many of these companies have is a toxic one that monetizes information and data based on individualized targeted ads and a lot of the problems of misinformation, disinformation, democratic collapse and fakes and everything are embedded into this. So I think we really need to consider significant digital ad taxes. Third, I think these companies are among the largest companies humanity has ever seen. We should seriously talk about breaking them up. Fourth, our tax code subsidizes using capital and algorithms instead of people, and that creates an excessive bias for automation. So I think we should try to level the playing field. And fifth, I think we should think of reforms of the AI community more broadly so that AI researchers actually work in using these technologies in human-friendly ways, trying to make humans more empowered and more productive. I think that comes from incentives, market policies, but I think the AI community also needs to sort of wake up to the priority of these issues.
If I were to push on the breaking up policy, it seems like the nature of the AI instruments that we're building is that the larger the data set, the more powerful they become, which suggests that there may be sort of feudal-style market structures driving towards concentration. What's the set of policies you could adopt that would allow you to still build the data sets that make maximally powerful AI systems that are, you know, useful and valuable while still preserving competition and preventing the sort of monopolies that might make dangerous?
Well, I think that's a very, very good point, but I will pass that to Alexander as well, because I think the evidence that there are huge increasing returns to scale to more and more data is actually not so conclusive. Second, a lot of the bigness of these companies comes from the fact that they have acquired lots of businesses in somewhat unrelated things. Whole Foods by Amazon, you know, WhatsApp competitors, Instagram competitors by Facebook. So that's not necessarily a natural data externality or data increasing returns issue. And third, there's a lot of evidence showing that many of these companies acquire and kill many competing ads, sort of the so-called killer acquisitions. Again, makes the whole thing much less competitive and themselves very big.
Alexander?
Yeah, so a couple of comments on that. I am not sure if breaking up these companies is really a solution. It might make sense in some cases, it might make less in others. The problem might be that if you have many smaller companies, they might actually be even more competing among each other, with kind of the externalities of this being even more negative. So we need to be a bit careful there. Also, some of the big companies in this space, like OpenAI or Anthropic, you know, they are very focused companies, actually. So it's not that they are acquiring that much. There's a good question about the kind of how much there is how much you can benefit from the scale. I do agree with Laron that this is still, like, we have seen some promising developments in this space, or essentially some positive evidence. I would not call this evidence conclusive. And I think understanding that will be actually key for us to understand how the supply chain, how the market will be structured kind of long term, and whether there is some need for regulation and correction of that. But again, I do think in terms of regulation, first of all, there is a lot of regulation that already exists, and it touches on many AI-related topics, and we should just figure out how to enforce and translate it. And the other aspect is that essentially policymakers should, and I think they do, pay attention to what's happening, look for the unintended or kind of negative outcomes, and be ready to counteract them. Maybe this will require a new agency that is focused just on doing that. But yes, definitely we need to keep a very close eye on that.
Well, I'm sure this won't be the last time we're talking about this. Daron, Alexander, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you.